Welcome to the part 2 of the business current affairs. I trust that it is comprehensive to all of you that including the business current affairs in the classroom teaching not only is perceived as beneficial by the students, but linking it with the theory brings more respect for the classroom sessions. We will continue with some more news and their implications. Friends, do you know that India has jumped nicely in global innovation index? India has in fact moved up by 5 places to rank 52 in the global innovation index 2019, that is up from 57 it had in the last year's ranking and 81 in the 2015, courtesy the report by the World Intellectual Property Organization WIPO. Now, the encouraging point is that India is consistently among top in the world in major innovation drivers that are ICT services export, graduates in science and engineering, the quality of universities, gross capital and creative goods exports. Now, WIPO has mentioned that India is doing very well in science and technology clusters, and the places like Bangalore, Mumbai, New Delhi are now listed among the top 100 global clusters. But there are some concerns, some aspects where India has lost relative strength is in the logistics performance, where our position has dropped by 9 spots, while for women employed with advanced degrees, our position has dropped by about 10 spots. And furthermore, when it comes to printing and other media, our position has dropped by about 12 spots. So, we can emphasize on the merits of innovation and ask the students to Google and bring 1 to 2 innovative initiatives by India, be it startups or government, and discuss in the classroom, and this assignment can be carried by students in a group of 4 to 5 also. Let us now look at the changes in CSR rules which many are talking about. Now, Indian Parliament has recently passed amendments to the Companies Act to strengthen laws governing corporate social responsibility, and few of Indian companies may feel or face higher compliance and management costs due to this. Now, you may be aware that the laws governing the CSR were notified in the Companies Act 2013 and became effective from 2014, and they state that companies that have a net worth of rupees 500 crore or revenue of 1000 crore or net profit of rupees 5 crore during the immediately preceding fiscal year are needed to spend 2% of their average net profits in the last 3 years on certain predefined activities related to sanitation, education, conservation of heritage, arts, culture and so on. Now, as of now, Reliance, ONGC, NTPC, TCS, Infosys are the big CSR spenders, and at time, you know, they are spending more than 2% also. Spending on CSR has gone up from 10,066 crores in 2014-15 to about 13,327 crores in 2017-18. And out of this, over 21,300 companies obliged to the report their CSR activities in 2017-18, and over 10,800 have complied. Now, CSR spending between 2014-15 and 17-18 was the highest in education, health, fight against poverty and malnutrition, access to clean drinking water, livelihood and for the differently abled. Now, if a company was unable to fully spend the prescribed CSR amount, it was permitted to carry this amount forward and spend it in the next 12 months. But as per the new laws, any unspent amount will have to be deposited in an escrow account within 1 month or 30 days from the end of that fiscal year. Now, such amount needs to be spent within 3 years, else will be put into a fund which could even be the Prime Minister's relief fund. Now, companies who do not follow CSR norms will be required to pay fines ranging from 50,000 rupees to 25 lakhs. And furthermore, the officers concerned may be liable for imprisonment of up to 3 years. Now, after this move, the government has expanded the scope of CSR spending. And as you may know that companies were allowed to provide CSR fund to technology incubators located within centers approved academic institutions. Now, the companies can contribute towards research across various fields, for instance, science, medicine, etc. And money can be spent on incubators funded by the center or state or any state-owned companies also. Now, in light of this, Jaiveer Singh, the vice chairman and the president of PwC India Foundation, has said that the thrust towards research-based innovation is a much-needed step in the right direction. Integration with established private enterprises in key sectors will provide the required impetus for a future-ready economy. An additional focus to drive social enterprises, to drive localized enterprise and employment opportunities, especially around key social services, should be encouraged. CSR violations would now not be treated as criminal offense and will be a civil liability. And this has been declared by the finance minister few days back. Now, this should come as a respite for the companies. After discussing this, we may ask the students to visit corporate websites to find pattern of CSR spending. And some of them who are interested to make career in social sector may benefit from this. There are also some portals and organizations that are conducting events on CSR, which can be attended by such students to initiate networking. Now, I would personally suggest to visit the portal indiacsr.in, on which you can find what corporate are doing and all latest news about CSR and all you need to know about. And then BSE has started registering NGOs and corporate on bsesamman.com. And here there is a listing fee after which the NGOs and the corporate can join hands. Time to talk about the Bitcoins. Bitcoin price was about $2,000 each in 2015, and which has now jumped to $9,500. In September 2019, and some months before, the price even reached $11,000. Now, today on 25th September, a Bitcoin equals about 7 lakh Indian rupees. One of the draft bills in India proposes 10-year prison term for dealing in cryptocurrency. Now, as we know that a cryptocurrency is a digital or virtual currency applying cryptography for the purpose of security and is generally based on blockchain technology. Now, that is distributed ledger normally enforced by a certain network or computer system. Bitcoin is considered as the most popular cryptocurrency in the entire world. As youth are interested to make quick money, but do they know that holding or selling or dealing in cryptocurrencies such as Bitcoin could soon land them into jail for 10 years. The banning of cryptocurrency and regulation of official digital currency bill 2019 draft has proposed that 10-year prison sentence should be applicable for persons who mine or generate or hold, sell, transfer, dispose, issue or even deal in the cryptocurrencies. Besides making it completely illegal, the bill makes holding of cryptocurrency a non-bailable offense. We need to tell our students that owing to the high chances of cryptocurrencies being misused for money laundering, governments across the world or their bodies such as the Income Tax Department in India are in the favor of banning cryptocurrencies like the Bitcoin. In the meantime, the government in India may launch a digital rupee also. Friends, after the demonetization of 500 and the 1000 rupee currency notes, we all started realizing that cash was unreliable. But some youth turned to Bitcoin. In fact, many were already using Bitcoins. Bitcoin enables people to make financial transactions quickly and securely without owning a bank account. And over 500 merchants in India and 5 large corporate including Dell accepted payments in cryptocurrency. This number was fast growing And in the month of August, market intelligence from Goldman Sachs suggested that investors to take advantage of the price dip and buy bitcoins. It is also said by Goldman that based on the Elliott wave analysis, the Bitcoin would find support around $11,000, and there is a scope to move to $12,000 and then $13,000 also. One of the popular financial advisors, Ms. Monica Halan, has also suggested investors to stay away from Bitcoin. We can suggest the students to avoid Bitcoins and look for other ways for making the steady returns. And in this backdrop, one may analyze how different investments have yielded the return. Different avenues have generated different return. Here one may compare investment avenues based on return, risk, marketability, tax shelter, convenience, and values and ethics. We may ask the students to compare return on bank FD, stocks, gold, etc., adjusted for transaction cost, convenience, income tax, and see the short term and the long term perspectives. Remember that building a portfolio is a complex exercise. Next, let us look at the sovereign gold bonds, which are better compared to investing in gold in form of coins or jewelry. The weak global economic outlook and the US-China trade war tensions and stock market position has pushed up the gold prices. Analysts believe that gold as an asset class should have 5 to 15% composition of the total investment portfolio. The sovereign gold bonds, or the SGB scheme, launched in November 2015 is getting popular, and its objective is to reduce the demand for physical gold and shift a part of the domestic savings into the financial assets. Now, some interesting aspects about the SGB scheme are that the government, in consultation with the Reserve Bank of India, has decided to offer a discount of rupees 50 per gram less than the nominal value to investors who are applying online. Now, these bonds will be sold through the scheduled commercial banks, Stockholding Corporation of India, etc. The gold bonds are issued in denominations of 1 gram and in multiples, and the maximum limit of subscription is 4 kg for individuals and Hindu and the divided family per fiscal year, while that for the trusts and similar entities is 20 kg. Investors in the gold bonds not only earn the appreciated value of gold, but also 2.5% interest per annum. This interest is paid semi-annually. However, there is a lock-in period of 5 years on the gold bonds, post which the premature redemption is permitted, while the maturity period is 8 years. Sovereign gold bonds are also traded on stock exchanges if held in the demat form, offering an early exit option to investors. On maturity, the redemption price will be based on simple average of closing price of gold of 999 purity of previous 3 business days from the date of repayment, as published by the India Bullion and Jewelers Association. However, the interest earned on the SGB is taxable as per the subscriber's tax bracket, but the capital gains arising from the redemption of SGB to an individual on maturity has been fully exempted, and indexation benefits will be provided for the long term capital gains arising for any person on the transfer of bonds. Now, these securities can be used as collateral for loans. So, the SGB seem to be good as the option is quite better than gold ETF, but the only issue for the latter is requirement of the demat account and favorable tax exemption, as in case of SGBs does not exist. So, we can encourage our students to ask their parents to invest via the SGB or gold ETF if they wish to look at gold as an investment. One more update is that India is planning to raise $10 billion from its first foreign bond sale. The idea of sovereign bond has been discussed by Indian governments in the past, but it was never taken up. So, some former central bankers have also opposed this plan owing to the perceived risk from currency fluctuations. Typically, the more financially strong the country is, the more well respected is the sovereign bond, and this is true with the US and Britain, and you will find that they are more active. But if we can ensure a stable currency, such move may be of benefit to the entire nation. Now, this in turn would depend on controlling the macroeconomic indicators, which is not so easy. So, let us see what happens. Finally, we find that mutual fund investors are getting smarter. As per the news reports, the driving force for mutual fund investments are SIP flows, which have averaged rupees 8000 crores for the 12 months till August, and the investors are also moving out of the riskier segments of credit risk funds and moving towards others such as the corporate bond funds. The awareness about mutual funds has gone up significantly after investor awareness campaigns and disappointment from the other asset classes, and now people know more about the mutual funds and have become smart with their pattern of investments, choice and selection criteria also, and this is good for the market and therefore for the economy as well. Mutual funds now offer much more variety and seem attractive, but generally our students consider them as quick ways of making money. The question is what we can tell them so that in our sessions, let us tell them that the right way to choose a mutual fund, what is the right way, let us tell them, and we should also explain them the merit of regular investing. I trust you found contents of the modules as useful and would encourage your students to read Business Current Affairs and suggest them to read Between the Lines, because lots of news are sponsored in nature and therefore they are not a kind of writing on the wall. But one thing is clear, that the inclusion of current affairs would certainly make the learning much, much better. Thank you very much. Yeah.